Now started, so those who want to go to Children's Church, you can send your children there now as we prepare for the Word of God. Amen? Amen. Turn with me to the book of Luke. Amen. We're back in the book of Luke, the 13th chapter, verse 18 through 21. Luke, the 13th chapter, 18 to 21. You're going to have it on the screens up there. You're going to see it if you do not have your Bibles. Luke 13.
Okay.
And I'll read it for me. This is coming from the New King James Version. It's going to be in Luke. If you have it, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Luke 13, verse 18. Through 21. Very familiar passage of scripture for those who know it. And it reads as follows. Then he said, "What is the kingdom of God like? And to what shall I compare it? It is like a mustard seed, which a man took and put in his garden, and it grew and became a large tree, and the birds of the air nested in its branches." Verse 20 and 21. And again he said, "To what shall I liken the kingdom of God? It is like leaven, which a woman took and hid in three measures of meal till it was all leavened." Amen. You may be seated for hearing God's word. I'd like to use for a subject just for a few minutes. Have you made an impact in somebody else's life? Have you made an impact in someone's life? Let us bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come to you, giving your name the praise and glory and honor, thanking you for everything that you have done. Heavenly Father, we thank you for allowing us to preach your word this morning. Thank you for your children who have come out to study with us. Heavenly Father, let your word make a mark upon us that will never ever be erased. And if somebody is here today that does not know Jesus Christ as their Savior, Heavenly Father, after hearing the word and being pricked by the Holy Spirit, we want them to say, "What must I do to be saved?" In Jesus' name, amen. Have you made an impact in someone's life? If you want to, you can text your family and friends and let them know that we are live now on Facebook at Christian Life Baptist Church Facebook page. We are live there. And some of you are recording as well. Just let them know that we are live now so they can get the word of God. Amen. So as we continue our study through the ministry of Jesus Christ, we come to our passage of scripture. And I just want to let you know, I'm not going to be long with you because this message is so simple and so impactful to you that you should get it the first time around. Amen. Amen. But Jesus here, because he talked to them through the scriptures and wanted them to understand what he was saying, Jesus used parables a lot. And we gotta understand what a parable is. It's really a earthly illustration for a spiritual meaning. Say that again, a parable is an earthly illustration for a spiritual meaning. And so Jesus often used a lot of parables. There in this passage of scripture, we find out, and just like in Zechariah, we found this out. Zechariah is receiving a vision from God, and he said this: "Who has despised the day of small things?" This message is about God taking small things and doing big things with it. God taking small things and doing big things with it. And who despises small things, as Zechariah says? Can I tell you, America despises small things? We despise small things. We have come to believe that bigger is always better. We tend to recognize in America and respect and remember those things that in life that are big, while we tend to give little thought to the small things in life. Our world, our secular world, is mandated by the big I little you syndrome. People think that they are bigger than you. People that think that they're more important than you, and that you're the little person and they're the big person. That's the attitude of our country. You see, the devil loves to use this false theology against you. The devil loves for you to believe that you are a little you and God can't use you, right? And the devil will always come to you with these ideas. He'll tell you, you are not good enough. Yeah. Have you ever heard this? You are not significant. And the devil says this, you don't have enough money. The devil tells you, you don't even have enough talent. The devil tells you, you aren't important enough to be used by God in a meaningful way. And when it comes down to spiritual matter, bigger is not always better. Now, we're going to talk about being bigger. That's a different issue. I think we got it wrong when we talk about bigger. When we talk about bigger, when you get bigger, you got to do things differently. That's all you need to understand about being bigger. Yes, God will get you bigger, but guess what? When you become bigger, things will change. Organization will change. Things in your life will change when you become bigger. But guess what? Before you become bigger, you got to start off small. So you can't despise small things. Did you know that God, when he sees you on judgment day, he's not going to reward you, and he's not going to be looking at you for your medals, for your degrees, and for your diplomas, amen. Right? Amen. He's going to be looking for scars. That's what he's going to be looking for. So as we come to this passage of scripture in Luke chapter 13, Jesus talks about two parables, right? He talks about two parables back to back in Luke 13, 18 through 21. Now, the first parable that Jesus talked about was the parable of the mustard seed. And the second parable that Jesus talked about was the parable of the leaven. So point number one, yeah, the two parables, as you can see it on the screen. Let's talk about these two parables. Point 1A, let's talk about the first one, the parable of the mustard seed, verse 18. And it says this. Then he said, what is the kingdom of God like? And to what shall I compare it? Verse 19, it is like a mustard seed, which a man took and put in his garden, and it grew and became a large tree, and the birds of the air nested in its branches. So right off the bat in Jesus' first example of his parable, Jesus says God is working, and he's working like through a mustard seed, which a man took and planted in his garden, and it grew and became a tree. And the birds of the air perched in its branches. Did you know in Jesus' day, the smallest seed that a person could plant was the mustard seed? And you might ask, say, well, how small is a mustard seed? The mustard seed is so small that it looks like coffee grounds. That in order for you to see it, you actually have to wet your fingertips, dip your finger into the seed so it can stick to your finger so you can actually see what they look like. That's how small a mustard seed is. The mustard seed was the smallest seed ever sown in the first century Israel when Jesus came upon the earth. Now, here is the comparison in the parable. Even though the mustard seed is the smallest seed, it grew to be one of the largest trees that grew in that area. This tree could grow from a mustard seed up between 8 feet to 12 feet tall. So the impact that this tree would have is that the branches in this tree would grow to be so big and so strong that birds would begin to start their families inside of it. This tree was so big and so impactful that the rest of the community that saw that their families were impacted by even the shade of the tree. So we have our first comparison that Jesus was making, and he says, I'm taking something very small, watch this, making something very large out of it. So you can't despise small things. God can take whatever is small and turn it into a big thing. So I say amen. Amen. Brings me to point 1B. That's the parable of the mustard seed. He gave another parable right back, right after it. He says, okay, wait a minute. Maybe you didn't understand that parable. Let me give you another one. He gave the parable of the leaven. Maybe we can understand this. Start in verse 20. And again, he said, to what shall I liken the kingdom of God? Verse 21, it is like leaven, which a woman took and hid in 3 measures of meal till it was all leavened. Now, maybe this parable, you might not understand the mustard seed, so maybe you can understand baking. So watch this. He says, in Jesus' day, you know, they had to bake every day. They didn't have a luxury to have a refrigerator to take stuff and store it and refrigerate it. So they had to bake every day. So this is what they did. When they had one dough to make a loaf of bread, they would take a piece of the yeast, the dough that had the yeast in it, they would save it for the next day. And when they made their next batch of bread the next day, they would take that piece that they saved from the other day, and they would put it in the dough, and they would knead it, and it would, guess what? That yeast would get all through the dough and make the second loaf of bread rise at the same time. So what was the impact? The impact was this, that one little small piece of dough can affect the whole loaf of bread, amen? Just one small thing can affect the whole thing. And what Jesus is saying is this, even in the original smallness is this, it can affect everything in your life. Which brings me down to point number 2. So we talked about the parables, you know what they are, the tree and the bread. What was Jesus teaching us? What was he trying to teach us? And Jesus, he wasn't teaching about trees and baking. Do you understand that? Jesus was revealing a kingdom truth. And you got to get this kingdom truth. And that's this. When it comes down to spiritual things, God uses small things to do big stuff.
Amen.
See, people, you know, they look at their smallness or the smallness of a church or even the smallness of stature of a person and think that God can't use them. But guess what? God can use anybody, amen? And we might see this thing being too small or being insignificant, but that's not what God sees. God sees something he wants to accomplish. God sees it already done. God sees the purpose of a thing, amen? Which brings me now to the next point. Point 2A is this. I want to give you 3 proof texts that prove that God will use small things and turn them into big things. The first one is found in 1 Corinthians, verse 26 and 27. And it says this, remember, dear brothers and sisters, that few of you were wise in the world's eyes or powerful or wealthy when God called you. Instead, verse 27, God chose things the world considers foolish in order to shame those who think they are wise. And he chose things that are powerless to shame those who are powerful.
Amen.
So yes, God will take the small things that you think is insignificant and turn it around on you and let you know that nothing is insignificant to God. Nothing is too hard for God. Nothing is too small for God. If God want to use it, he's going to use it. Amen? Yes, he will. Second scripture I want to show you is this one. It's found in Zechariah chapter 4, verse 6. It's also on the screen. This is where the angel told Zechariah the following message for Zerubbabel and recorded it for us in verse 6. Listen to this. Then he said to me, this is what the Lord says to Zerubbabel. It is not by might nor by strength, but by my spirit, says the Lord of heaven. God doesn't do anything by might or by human strength. He does everything by his spirit. Everything that he has done in your life, he's done by the power of the Holy Spirit. If you look back over your life and look at all the things that were accomplished in your life, can you say that it was you by yourself that did it? Or can you say it was God that made a way? It was God that opened that door. It was God that blessed me. It was God that healed me. It was God that delivered me. You got to say it was God all the way. Amen. Last passage to prove to you that God can use small things this morning is this one. It's found in 1 Samuel chapter 16 and verse 7. Some of you have all read this, already understand this passage of scripture. It talks about when God went to look for another king of Israel. After Saul disobeyed God, God said, I got to find another king. So he went to a man's house by the name of Jesse. Jesse had 8 sons. And everybody thought, even the prophet Samuel thought. He said, okay, there he is right there. He looked at the first son of Jesse and said, he's going to be our new king. But verse 7 says something different. Listen to this. He says, the Lord said this to him, do not look at his appearance or at his physical stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord does not see as man sees. For man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. Can somebody say amen? See, we look at what people look at on the outside. We look at what people look like in height and stature and beauty. He said that's not how God looks at people. He looks on the inside. God looks at the heart. And it brings me down to my last point. I'm going to my seat after this. And the last point is this. We need to understand what ministry is. That's what this scripture is about. We need to understand this. We need to see that what I'm doing right now this morning, people will call it ministry, but what I'm doing is not ministry. What I'm doing is preaching and teaching. What I'm doing is trying to help you grow in Christ. That's not ministry. You know what ministry is? Ministry is what you do during the week.
That's right.
Ministry is what you do when you help somebody. Ministry is feeding the hungry. Yeah. Ministry is clothing the naked. You know, some people think that they got their ministry. Oh, I've been to church. I have my ministry since because I heard the word of God. Hearing the word of God is not ministry.
That's right.
Hearing the word of God is growing, because you got to put in action what you hear. And if you don't put in action what you hear, then how do you say you're walking in ministry? So guess what? Guess what? So feeding the hungry, yes. Ministry is involved in small things, little acts, small gestures in everyday service. If you don't believe me that God will start something small, and he started small and made it big, and you don't know anything about the church then. The Christian church started with one person named Jesus Christ. You know that? Jesus started the church, and the church began to grow. How fast did the church grow with Jesus? 12. That's how far it grew. 12 people grew out of Jesus. Wait a minute. It didn't stop there. And some people might have said, well, Jesus, your ministry only lasted with 12 people, or maybe a few people that followed them. But how many of you know, if you read the book of Acts, that after Jesus died on the cross and after he ascended into heaven, there was a day called the Day of Pentecost, which was really a normal holiday anyway. But the scripture says that Peter preached on that day, and 3,000 came to Jesus Christ. Who's small now? who's looking at ministry now? Now, God can take 12. He took 12 and turned into 3,000. And guess what? It wasn't all the 12 that preached. Only one of them preached that day. And 3,000 came to Jesus. Oh, there were that mustard seed right there. Remember, you can start off small. But guess what? God don't want you to stay small. He wants you to grow to being bigger. Oh, yes, yes. Well, every church be a mega church? Well, it depends on your mustard seed faith. Because I can't say it won't. And I can't say that God don't want it to be. I'm telling you, based on your mustard seed faith, God can do anything that he wants to do, right? If he wants your church to grow, then guess what? It will grow. But you gotta have the fire. You gotta have the will. You gotta have the know-how to say, God, I want you to use me to be an impact to somebody's life. Amen. Oh yeah, yeah, that means this. That means this. When you say you need mustard seed faith, watch this. What you're saying is everything that you need for your ministry is in that mustard seed. Everything that you need is in the yeast. Did you know that the bread grew because of the yeast? But the yeast was always the yeast, right? The mustard seed, the 8-foot tree, the 12-foot tree was in that little mustard seed on the fingertip of a person. Everything that you need in God is in the mustard seed, right? So if the mustard seed represents faith, then everything that you need from God is in your faith. So my question is, what kind of faith do you have? But what kind of faith are you walking with? You might say, well, I got great faith. We're not asking for great faith. We just asking for little seed, right? We just asking for mustard seed faith. It don't take great faith for your church to grow. It don't take great faith for God to do something for you. Guess what it takes? Mustard seed faith. It just takes the faith of the grain of a mustard seed for you to be experiencing, guess what? An impactful life style in your life. Listen to this before I go to my seat. Can I give you a quiz real quick? I want you to answer these questions. Don't answer them out loud, but answer them to yourself real quick. Let me give you these four questions. Watch this. Name the last five Heisman Trophy winners. That's number one. Number two, name the last five winners of the Miss America contest. Question number three. I can't give you enough time to answer. I'm gonna just go ahead again, because I know you don't know. Number three. Name 10 people who have won the Nobel Peace Prize. Number four. Name the Academy Award winner who won Best Actor and Best Actress in 1982. So you said, okay, I don't know none of them. I don't know. Okay, watch this. Some people think that those questions are very important. And those questions that I just gave you are very important people that won very important things, right? But I'm gonna give you four more questions. And I guarantee you that you can answer these questions I'm gonna give you quicker than you can answer the last four questions I gave you. Question number one, can you name the teacher who helped you along the way when you went to school? Number two, can you name a friend that helped you through a difficult time? Question number three, name somebody who taught you something worthwhile. Question number four, think of somebody who made you feel appreciated and special. Automatically, you come up with somebody's name. Automatically, you know somebody. It didn't take you long to get those answers, amen? So the people who made a difference in your life, the people who were significant in your life, the people who made an impact in your life, those are the people who are the ones that made the greatest impact for you. These are the people that have the most credentials in your life for you. And guess what the credentials are not? These are the people, they may not have any money. These people may not have awards behind their names. These are the people, though, who went down into their heart, saw your need, and helped you along the way. Somebody need to say amen. These are the people that when you didn't have a dime, they blessed you. These are the people, when you didn't have a babysitter, they said, I'll watch your children for you. These are the people, when everybody gave up on you, they said, no, I'm not going to give up on you. Yeah, God will take a small thing, and he'll make it into a big thing. Can I ask you a question? What impact have you made in somebody's life? What impact can people remember about you? What have you done for somebody? Have you witnessed to them about Jesus? Have you helped somebody along the way? See, we got to understand that God will take small things like a mustard seed and turn it into a big thing in your life. So you need to understand, Christian life, we may be small now. Christian life, we can't compare ourselves to the church down the street. And I don't know about you, I have mustard seed faith. What you see is what I don't see. But what I see the 5,000. I don't know about you. I see the 10,000. How can you see 10,000 in a 100 seat room? Because it's in a mustard seed faith. You see, you got to have a faith that God can use you to grow. Yes, see, we got to grow in Christ. If you don't see yourself growing, you can't grow in Christ. Mustard seed faith says you gotta see it before you get it. You can't wait to 2,000 and say, ain't God good? You can thank God for the 2,000 right now. You can thank God for the 5,000 right now. Because see, while you thank him for that, you prepare yourself for that. If we think that we're gonna stay small, if you think we're gonna stay here, then you got the wrong mission. God created us to grow. God created us to move on. Can I tell you what else I see? I just don't see the west side Christian life. I see the east side Christian life. I see a north side Christian life. I see a south side Christian life. That's what I see. That's what my mustard seed faith tell me. And some of you might say, you got to be crazy. We ain't going nowhere further than this. But I'm telling you, that's what faith will do. Faith will be able to see what God sees. But if you have a love, that God has in his heart. He said this. He said, God said, I don't want to see any man perish. I want to see them come unto Jesus Christ. So therefore, that means this. The harvest is ripe, but the labor is few. You can tell me, it's more than 10,000 people in the streets of Detroit that don't know Jesus Christ. It's more than 10,000 people, but all the churches we have, somebody needs food. It's more than 10,000 people just in this city that need a place to stay. It's more than 10,000 people just in this city that need some help. And you mean to tell me God can't use Christian life to help that 10,000? God can't use Christian life to bring them all in, tell them about Jesus Christ, feed them, clothe them, put them in a house, counsel them, raise their children, teach them the word of God. That's what God called us to do. We are here to be an impact. We are here to make an impact in somebody's life. Shout impact. Shout impact. Not just in Christian life, but in your life. When you own your job, say impact. When you're in your home, say impact. When you're at the grocery store, say impact. That's why God has given leaders the vision. That's why a leader can walk into an empty supermarket and see a mega church. That's what impact will do. You can't tell me what God can't do. You can take us from this room into a supermarket room, but you gotta have mustard seed faith. To believe that you receive, and you gotta say, yeah, that's the church that said they're gonna grow. That's the church that said they're gonna be an impact. But what I tell you, if you don't think that God can make an impact, I got a few witnesses here with me. Can I tell you, it was God who took Abraham and Sarah when they thought they couldn't have a child. God gave them a child in their old age. Somebody shout impact. Well, it was God who took Moses and pulled the children of Israel after 400 years of slavery. Somebody shout impact. It was God who took Israel across the Red Sea when they thought that they were going to die. Somebody said impact. It was Jesus who took a little boy's lunch and fed 5,000 people. Somebody say impact. When Jesus wants you, when Jesus used you, you're going to be an impact. You're going to be a circle, a person that of influence. You're going to change your circle of friends. You're going to change your community. You're going to change your home. You're going to change your job. Shout impact. Shout impact. Jesus came down from heaven for two generations ago. He died so he could be an impact. He shed his blood so he could be an impact. Jesus got up on the third day with all power in heaven and earth in his hands to be an impact for you and for me. Somebody say thank you, Lord. Somebody say thank you. In the name of Jesus, we thank you for being an impact. We thank you for being the one in our lives that changed us. We thank you for putting our feet on solid ground. We thank you for turning our hearts from stone into a heart of flesh. We thank you for making an impact in our lives. But now, Father, we want to move a step further, and we want to be an impact in somebody else's life. Use us, God. Use us, Lord. Use us for your service. Use us to grow this church. Use us to help this city. Use us to help the hurting. Use us to help the homeless. Use us to help those on the streets, those who don't know Jesus as their Savior. Use us, Father. So you created Christian life for that reason. You created us to be an impact to the people around us. And we give your name the praise. We give your name the the glory. We give your name the honor right now. In Jesus' name. There may be somebody here who don't know Jesus as their Savior. And right now, every head is bowed.